Friday Night with Dean Aldridge, sponsored by Mrs. CA Cakes.
Hi, I'm Jack Obanks.
This is Chelsea Lee Stokes.
I'm Alex Stringer.
And I'm Julia Raby.
I'm David Broadbent.
I'm Sam Hepworth.
And this is Friday Night with Dean Aldridge.
Another series of Friday Night with Dean Aldridge. There might only be two episodes, but it's still gonna be boss. Here's your first guest. It's Mr. Jack Gilbanks with his song Amongst the Streets of Liverpool.
Let me tell you about a place along an Jersey shore. This is my hometown, the place where I was born. Don't you see? There's no place I'd rather be. When you see the waterline, you will be so blind. Everyone you speak to, they will be so sad. I promise you, there's nothing I would rather do than to be amongst the streets of Liverpool. There's no place to comprehend. Again, I see everyone I know. This just brings me so much joy. I would never go. I'm begging thee, please don't ever let me leave. The history is so surreal, it will blow your mind. Get yourself out in town, it's not that hard to find. I swear it's true, there's nothing I would rather do than to be amongst the streets of Liverpool. There's no place to comprehend, to my home city. This is where I belong, the place of my dreams. I don't wanna go away, I just wanna stay. Stay amongst the streets of Liverpool. This is where I belong, the place of my dreams. I don't wanna go away, I just wanna stay. Stay amongst the streets of Liverpool. Stay amongst the streets of Liverpool. Well, I'll stay.
First guest this series is Miss Liverpool personality and Miss England finalist. It's Chelsea Lee Stokes. How are you doing?
Hi, I'm good.
Thanks for coming, Chelsea.
You're
brilliant to have you here. First of all, I'm just going to start. You just said if I don't introduce you as Chelsea Lee Stokes, your mother will rip my head off. What's all that about?
She would. She honestly would. If I say my name's Chelsea, she goes, it's Chelsea Lee.
Full name, full title.
It does sound better though.
Yeah.
Instead of just Chelsea.
I've got two little girls and like, the only time I use their full names if I'm angry with them, yeah. It's like Nevy or Zara, or but then it's like Zara Ann, and she's like,
oh,
she
knows that straight away. That's a nice name, though.
She knows straight away. Then, obviously, Miss Liverpool, Miss England. We'll get into that in a minute, but I want to start talking about your businesses. I Am Woman Gym.
Yeah.
I Am Woman Beauty. I Am Woman Clothing. I mean, what's next? I Am Woman Cinema. I Am Woman Restaurant.
Yeah. Just smashing. Going bigger.
It's great. How did it all start?
So I started working in a ladies only gym, and then I've always wanted my own gym, and then I left about 3 years ago and a building came up and I thought, why not start
my own
business, and then just went for it. And then 3 months after getting my gym, another building came available, and then I ended up getting that for selling. So it just all kind of came together as I went along.
So your gym itself, is it for like strictly women or?
Yeah, so it's ladies only.
Brilliant.
So now men are out.
It is a big part, and like a lot of women fear going to the gym and getting looked at and stuff. So.
I think women do feel more comfortable training when there's just women there. Like I don't mind training with men as well, but a lot of women, for like confidence reasons, they like going by themselves, like where there's just women, like they won't have to wear makeup, or they can go just straight after work and not be bothered how they look. So now it is nice being ladies only.
Has it been successful? Like, are you getting a lot of people coming and a lot of people enjoying
it's being that good. Like, there's been some people who said, oh, like, it's sexist, but then if the women feel comfortable and they're opening up in the gym and they're better than themselves, then that's all you can ask for.
100%. It's a, do you know what, it's a similar idea to what I've got, and I'm probably going to give you another business idea here, but I think it's a good idea to get out there. I haven't got the money to set up, Chelsea, that's what I'm saying. You probably have.
What is it?
But I am woman taxi, Chelsea. women only taxi drivers. No, you don't see a future for that. You just looked at me there like, she's jibbing with your black Delta idea, you know what I mean? But that's not a bad idea. That only
it's
women.
Not a bad idea, but what's wrong with the men taxi drivers?
It's a lot of, just to do with the safety thing going on now. I'm not saying there's an issue.
It is, but say,
you know,
like,
what I mean?
I've got a brother and a dad. Yeah. I'd feel safe with them in a taxi. So, not all men are the same.
I'm not saying they are. Writing me off on my own show, 5 minutes in, and season two's going down earlier. Nice one. I'm so glad I asked you to come on, Chels. No, but what I'm saying is, like, obviously, there's a big security thing going on at the minute, and people are like, oh, I'm not going near men, or men should be locked up by 7 o'clock and all that paper.
Or,
do you know what I mean? I think some women would feel more comfortable just in a female-only taxi. That's just my idea. It's just an idea, anyway. If you're not taking it up, I'm going on Dragon's Den with it.
It's an alright idea, but...
No, nice one, Chels. Thanks for getting the honour.
I'm only putting money
on. One day, you'll be crying that you never go in 50% on that with me. Right, so Miss Liverpool popularity. How did you get involved in that?
So, I entered online. So, you've got to enter a talent. You've got to do
an
intro. So, it was more to do, say, with sports, so with being a personal trainer. I'd done all videos of me training, and then I've trained, say, women who were like 74 and then women who were 7. So, I put all them videos together and then just sent that as a talent.
Nice, okay.
And then we done, you've got to do a catwalk, and then, like, I've just sent them a picture with no makeup on. So, we done that, and then I got to the top 6. And then you go to a public vote, so then people vote for you. And then I won that, and then that qualifies you to go to the Miss England finals.
Brilliant. How many people are in Miss England?
So 44.
40, like every area?
Every area, yeah. So there's like Miss London, Miss Birmingham, and then we all come together.
When's the?
So August the 27th, it's just been pushed back in
Birmingham. How did you decide it? What are the kind of things you've got to do?
Well, there's 10 rounds, so it's actually not just about looks. Like, you've got to do a charity round, you've got to do, like, an interview, like, you do stuff to do with, like, recycling, like, you do learn a lot of stuff, like, even about the world by entering, because they're teaching you stuff that you should already know, that you should learn in school, but they're teaching you from the start of it, so it is good. And then there's talent rounds, there's catwalk rounds, there's a bareface round, so you enter with no makeup on. And then there's all there's 10 different ones, so you don't have to enter them all, right, so you can enter which ones you feel comfortable doing.
But the more you do, is it
the
more
you do, the more chance, so all the people that win each round, there'll be a grand final, which will be top 15.
Okay.
So the 10 rounds, if you win that, you go to the grand final, and then 5 extra are picked, like, by stars you're in. So it is good. Like, I think people think pageants are just about looks, which there is. You've got to raise, like, there's a category where you do a charity round, and it's how much you raise, so it does encourage you to raise money for all different charities.
What's your charity for? You're doing an event, aren't you?
Yeah, so that's for the Miss England charity.
Right.
So it's Beauty with a Purpose, so that's to raise money for disadvantaged children around the world. So there's all Miss Worlds, like, competitors around the world, they'll all raise money for it, where they raised like 4 million one year.
Wow.
So it is like a big charity where they help millions of kids around the world.
How do people get involved? And is it like a ticketed event, is it, or is it
like... Yeah, so my charity event, the charity night, the charity night is just where you buy tickets, where it's going to be in the Pioneer, and then I'm having all local acts and singers. Hopefully you.
I'll be there. We'll have a little talk about hosting it, you know what I mean? See how brilliant it is to have your own show. You get little gigs like that.
Yeah, so hopefully I raise a bit of money doing that.
So do you know when you're doing like Miss England and stuff like that, do you not feel like, you know, sabotaging like Miss Birmingham or something like that? You know, going to one of her nights and like...
No,
in what way? I'm going undercover, I'm like, do you know what I mean? Tripping waiters over and stuff like that.
Like, I've just chose to do that. Like, you do all different ways to raise money for charities. So I've applied to Swim at Sharks as well to raise money, and then you can do, like, I've teach, like, gym classes.
Sorry, that's hilarious. I am Miss England, I'm going to swim with sharks.
To raise money, and it's good, though.
That's, I mean... If that's going to get you the victory, fair play to you.
Yeah.
You done a skydive, didn't you? Was that part of it, or was that something totally different?
So that was for a different charity, which is Zoe's Hospice, so that's for children as well.
Right, okay.
So we done that. We jumped from 15,000 feet. It was good. Well, it was amazing. I'd say to anyone, it's worth doing.
Go on,
like, it's like a life experience that you'll always remember, which it is good.
You should do one. You should do a skydive. As you're coming down, you've got to try and do someone's makeup. See what they look like at the bottom. Have you seen people's faces when they're doing the
lot? But now, because of like COVID and all that, we had to wear like masks and all that when you're going down, so you couldn't like see our faces anyway, so we're too bad. But your skin does, like, because when you're going down, like, your skin like pushes back. So the pictures were good, but not like Instagram material, like, they weren't that good.
So, obviously, off camera, we had a little weird about your sister who couldn't join us tonight because she's busy. What's it like with your sister, like, at home? Is it like
it's boss?
Do you work together, don't you?
Yeah, we work together. So she works in my beauty salon as well. We do. She helps me. She like co-owns it, so she helps with handle with the girls, and then say if I'm away, she'll do stuff. So no, it's good.
Did ever just go like, bitch, please, I'm Miss Liverpool? Do you know what I mean? Just throw that at her.
No.
Go to shop for me. Like, no, good bitch,
please. I wanted her to do it with me. Like, I was trying to encourage her to enter with me, or maybe like next year when she keeps building off that, she does it as well.
Brilliant. Well, listen, best of luck with it. Is there any way people can help, like, vote towards you or anything like that, or support you and, like, obviously helping you win?
Yeah, near the time, there is like a public vote, so then everyone will go to a public vote. It's the same as I won the Miss Liverpool one.
Yeah.
They do like a Miss England one, and then you get all like your local, like Liverpool, they get everyone from Liverpool to try and vote for you.
Brilliant.
So hopefully near the time.
Bot on. And how can people follow you on socials and stuff like that?
So my Instagram is PT Chelsea Lee Stokes.
Okay.
That's my main social media that business. I use to promote
everything. Everything else is I Am Woman. Just type in I Am Woman on Instagram and whatever comes up, follow it.
I Am Woman Gym and I Am Woman Beauty and I Am Woman Clothing.
And soon to be I Am Woman Taxi as well. Chelsea, you've been great. Thank you for coming on.
Thank you for
your time.
Thank you for having me.
Chelsea Stokes. Sorry, Chelsea Lee Stokes. Sorry, mum. Sorry.
Thank you.
My next guest is comedian David Broadbent.
How you doing,
mate? You're all right?
Mate, I'm good, cheers. Yeah, good. Thanks for having me on.
Thanks for coming, mate. It's great to have you here. David, what a story you've got to tell, mate. I mean, obviously, I asked for a little bit of information on you, and what I got sent was a book, mate. You've done a lot, haven't you, through your time? Like, I'm going to start, David, from pretty much the beginning. You told me that your mum was a bookkeeper and she had to leave a job because of you.
That's true, yeah. My mum was a bookkeeper, my dad was a plumber, and at primary school I was a bit of a naughty boy, and the teacher didn't really know what to do with me. This is like the mid-80s. Teacher didn't really know what to do, and then one day I went out to play at dinner time, and my mum was still in the yard. I'm like, what are you doing here, mum? I'm your new dinner lady. So all the way through my primary school life, my mum was my dinner lady, pretty much just to keep an eye on me.
Brilliant. Yeah. What a story, mate. Obviously, we won't talk about all your childhood, and I bet you it would do us funny times and stuff like that. We'll talk about what you've been doing recently and stuff like that. So what better place to start than your time at the Daily Mirror, was it? Daily Mirror?
Yeah.
I mean,
I wasn't there long, but 2004, I decided to make the move to London. I'm from Oldham, and had the chance to go and work on the Daily Mirror in London. Canary Wharf, 23rd floor, all that. Thought, yeah, why not? I was 23 years old, thought, this is what we want to be doing right now. Yeah. And the editor at the time was quite famous. Piers Morgan was the editor at the time. And I was only there a few months because in that time was the time that Piers Morgan was relieved of his duties for the front page at the time with the all the stuff from Iraq with the fake picture of the prisoners of war.
Did the full team get let go because of it, or?
Oh, we kind of all walked out. I was on advertising sales, and I was working on the Daily Mirror at the time. Had a Friday pullout called the Ticket, all the entertainment stuff for a weekend, and we went from 1 week saying, it's fine, don't worry about it, to the next week ringing the same people and I'm going, we are not spending any more money with you. Last week you told us all was great. This week, not so much. So a load of us just kind of were looking around going, I mean, there's only so many times you can be called a knobhead in a certain day, really. There's only so many times you want to hear that when you sat there. So a load of us just kind of went.
Got up and went.
Just kind of gave the notice to them. We're like, yeah, this isn't really.
I mean, it's
us.
One for the CV, though, isn't it? Thoughts on. After that, David, you just kept going, mate. You were you became stadium announcer for Oldham.
Oh, yeah.
You landed on your feet there.
Mate, dream job for me. I'm a lifelong Oldham fan. We are statistically the least successful club in England in the last 30 years. So it's been a lot of fun. But I kind of always helped out there. And then the main guy doing it couldn't do it for a game. So I got kind of thrown in and asked to do it. It went okay. The main guy at the end of the season left. So I just kind of took over from there and did it for about 10, 15 years.
It's strange that because on season one, we had George Sefton on, who's Liverpool's announcer. And he's pretty much went through the same thing. He was telling us about, like, he went to the game with his wife and his wife said, oh, you can't do any better. And just by chance, he landed on his feet with it. It's mad how many people seem to fall into that role, isn't it?
Oh, it's weird. Yeah, it is. And that kind of, we'll come on it, but that's kind of, I started then on the back of that, hosting the corporate lounges at home and getting to interview the players before the game and after the game and all that, and that took me down a sort of presenting type route as well. So
I was going to bring that up later, David, but thanks for bringing that up earlier. Appreciate that, mate. We're on the subject now, you might as well speak about it. As you said there, sportsman's dinners and stuff like that, like, you must have met some great athletes and stuff like that from
It's such a lot of fun doing things like that. I kind of got into it because a local club that I played for needed a host one year, and I was like, how hard can it be? And then you have to stand up in front of 150 people and then you realise how hard it can be. But then I kind of got into it and really enjoyed it, and you get to work with some brilliant comedians, you get to work with some brilliant sports people, people like Neil Ruddock is unbelievable. Just give him a microphone and let him do his own thing. And then I was lucky enough to meet quite a lot of the England 1966 World Cup winning team that had done dinners, people like Gordon Banks, who's fortunately no longer with us, but they're always different, and they're always, you're raising money for usually a good cause, an amateur club, a grassroots club, and you get paid for having a good night.
What more do you want?
Absolutely, yeah.
It's funny you brought up Neil Ruddock there. I've got a story about Neil Ruddock, right? And I mean, he's the reason that my ex-girlfriend broke up with me, believe it or not.
I kind of dread to think where you're going with this.
No, it was brilliant, because we were on a night out in Liverpool city centre, and my girlfriend at the time, she went to the toilet, and she come back and she was fuming. And I was like, what's the matter with you? She went, that man over there at the bar just smacked my ass. I was like, what? Do you know what I mean? I'm 18-year-old lad. I'm not having that. I walked over. I was like, tapped him on the shoulder. Hey, did you just smack my bird's ass? And he turned around. It was Razor Ruddock. So from where she was stood, all she saw was me going over, tapping this lad on the shoulder and buying him a pint. I was like, well, yeah, she broke up with me for that. But I got to have a pint with Neil Ruddock. So
I mean, you know, swings around the bicycle, exactly. You know.
Just getting back onto where you were saying, you were working for Oldham. You had a role at Oldham when I actually visited Oldham when Liverpool played them in the FA Cup and they knocked us out.
I was the stadium announcer that day. So you're a Liverpool fan?
Yeah.
So that day, Steven Gerrard started on the bench. And
Suarez up front. I remember the full team.
The team was unbelievable. Yeah. We couldn't believe it. So we kind of knew before the game. So I was stood in the top of the tunnel when Liverpool arrived. And I don't even remember the weather had been horrendous.
Yeah,
it had been snowing. We had some ridiculous bubble on the pitch that the FA had given us to get the game on. And when Liverpool arrived, you saw Luis Suarez and Sebastian Coates, the tunnel at Oldham steps, and they had a look at the pitch, started walking back up, and as they walked back up, they were zipping the coats up and that. And I was stood at the top of the tunnel with Paul Dickov, who was Oldham's manager at the time, and we looked at each other and went,
"We've got these.
These do not fancy this one little bit." Mm-hmm. And Stephen Gerrard was on the bench that day.
Mm-hmm.
So we sat at the top, Brendan Rodgers at the bottom on the touchline. Oldham scored the third goal just as the second half started to go 3-1 up. About 5 minutes later, Stephen Gerrard just shouted down to Brendan Rodgers, "Gaffer, put me on now." And within 2 minutes,
he was on.
On he went. And
it was some strange day that. I mean, I remember as well, the full-time whistle goes, obviously all the Oldham fans still on the pitch and run towards the away end. We're all stood in the away end. Like, let's have it then, do you know what I mean? It was that, and the whole occasion was dreadful for us, but for yous. But what I noticed that day was there was quite a lot of Man United shirts in the crowd for Oldham that day.
I mean, yeah, it's kind of a thing for all of them. We're very close to Man City and Man United, and sadly, I mean, that game sold out. There were 13,500.
Yeah.
We don't have 13,500 fans, and the game sold out. So there were also in the home ends, plenty of Liverpool fans in the home ends that were kind of zipping shirts up as the game went on, and that sort of thing.
Something else I remember from that day was I used to go to match with a guy called Pav. And he was a big collector of programmes, match programmes. He hadn't missed one in years. And he had a couple on the back seat of the car that we went there in. And we had to park on this little muddy field. And as I've opened the door, like three of the programmes just fell out into this big puddle. I never told him, so he knows now, and he's going to be fuming, David. But yeah, I weren't Oldham's biggest fan after that, to be honest, but obviously you've had your success there. Tell us a little bit as well, David, about your radio show with Alex Carty. You had it again.
So again, these things have kind of all happened by chance. Alex used to be in Hollyoaks for years, and Emmerdale. We grew up together. He might look a lot younger, but he's only a year younger than me. And we were sort of mates all the way through school, so we grew up together. And one night we went out into a club in Oldham, and the club was called Tokyo Project, and it was kind of an indie club.
Mm.
And every Friday night, the Revolution radio station, that was an indie station in Oldham and Manchester, did a takeover. And one of the nights, the producer was in, and he approached Alex and said, introduced himself, "Do you fancy coming doing a one-off show about your favourite songs?" And Alex, said, "Yeah, only my mate can come and do it with me." So he went in, did this one-off show. A week later, we got a call saying, "Do you fancy coming doing it, like, permanently?" So we were like, "Yeah, absolutely." So we did Friday nights. We then got moved to, we did Saturday afternoon sports shows, which was great. Alex hosted from the studio, and I went up and down the country following Oldham, doing the radio reports on them, which was fantastic. Then the station got bought out, sadly. Steve Penk, the old wind-up guy, bought it out, and he changed all the music policy. It was no longer a cool indie station. Yeah. A lot of the presenters left. I didn't, because, quite frankly, they were still doing the sport, and I wanted to sort of see if I had a chance of kind of making it, if you like. The football season ended, and Steve called me into his office and said, "Right, I've got a new project for you." And I was like, "Brilliant," he said. "How'd you fancy doing Saturday nights, 9 till 1? And at the time, I was, like, single, so I was like, "Yeah, all right, well, I'm doing all right." I was, "Yeah, why not? That sounds great." And he started going, "The last hour of the show, it's going to be love songs." And I was like, "Last hour of the show, it's fine." About 3 or 4 weeks later, it moved from 10 p.m. till 2 a.m. and was 4 hours of love songs. I am not the voice of love in Oldham. He gave me this ridiculous character name. I was called Dr. Love. Oh, it was awful. I lasted about 2 months, and I remember people texting in, like, saying, "Oh, can you play this for me?" And I'm like, No, I can't.
It sounds like the worst James Bond villain ever, doesn't it?
Oh,
Dr. Love.
It was I hated every minute of it. Stuck it out for about 2 or 3 months and was like, "I just can't do this anymore." It was just soul destroying. I can't be that guy.
Brilliant.
Horrible.
Brilliant. Well, listen, thank you very much for coming on. You've been a great
guest. Thanks for having me.
Some fantastic stories, mate. I wish I could sit here and have a better chat with you, but I'm sure we can get you back at some point. Thank you for coming on, ladies and gents. David Broadman.
Cheers. Thank you.
So my next guests are the hosts of the Hypothesis podcast. It's Alex Stringer and Julia Ravey.
Hello.
guys.
Hello.
How are you doing? You good?
Good. And you got it right.
I got it right. Hypothesis. Correcting me off camera earlier on, Alex. Thank you very much for that. Girls, how are you doing? It's great to have you here. How's the podcast going?
Good. It's going fun. It's fun, isn't it? Like, we are almost finished our first season of the podcast. Yeah. We've just been doing it like every week. So it's a good excuse for me and Alex to get together and have a chat.
Tell us about it. It's like a obviously Alex is the comedy and you're the science behind it.
If you listen to it though, not really.
What do you mean, not really?
It's like, I would say that you're like, oh, it's not like me like knowing science, but like I think that because we're friends, we know how to like make each other.
Oh, we know how to like push each other's buttons.
Like I don't think anyone would listen and go, she's the comic. You know, personally.
What about you?
I would.
Yeah, I definitely would. Yeah. I know, yeah, I am.
A scientist is funny and a thick person like this.
It's unique. Oh, isn't it? It's a unique idea. There's not. I'm almost certain there isn't another comedy science mixture going on another
there
podcast.
Is, but not with two is women. There? Not with women.
Oh, right, yeah, I think that's the unique thing about it because I'm like a woman in science. And obviously that is now more common, but like it's historically not that common to have women in science who are quite young and out there. And so that's why me and Alex thought, let's get together and I can essentially talk science at Alex, teach Alex some science, and she can make me laugh.
I mean,
bring it together.
You really are like a genius in science, I've heard. I've heard you're really, really smart. Like, you're the reason Alex passed the GCSEs, I've heard.
Well, that's my biggest achievement. That's top of the CV, is I got Alex B.
Yeah.
In science.
Yeah.
Yeah, we used to sit at my kitchen table during GCSEs and Alex would come round and I used to do all these mind maps, didn't I, of all the topics in science, and Alex would take mine and copy it, wouldn't you?
Yeah. Is it a specific like area of science that you're involved in? Or?
Yeah, so I'm a neuroscientist, so brain is my...
What's that? I don't know.
Study the brain.
The brain? Yeah. Oh, right, okay.
Yeah. That's my area.
Trust me not to know what that was. Like the one part that I probably should have known was the brain. Brilliant. That's great. But how did you meet? Obviously, like I've heard it was you were like 12 years old and you were all proper into your theatre or something like that.
Yeah, so we went to like a Saturday, Sunday theatre school thing. And we were both in a musicale in the Empire, big, you know, stars were aligned and all that, and so we met there, and then we were just friends for years, like best friends for years, and then I ended up going to Julia's sixth form, and then since then
couldn't keep her away.
No,
couldn't keep her away. She came to my school.
Yeah, kind of stalkery.
It's nice though, isn't it? Like, it's not stalky, but it's nice though.
No, it was actually lovely.
Even after all these years, you're together doing a podcast together and stuff like that.
And that didn't happen like really like by like it was the best way of it happening because it was quite organic in the sense that like I was supposed to be starting with a podcast with a friend, and then he selfishly got a job for Broccoli, who make podcasts, so selfish. And I was talking to my gal pals, and I was like, so selfish. No, I wasn't. I was like, I'm so happy for him, but also not for me. And then Jules was like, oh, I've been meaning to start a podcast myself, but like, of how to go about whether I'm guests or one person or whatever, and so we set up a Zoom as one does during a pandemic, and so we were like batting ideas off, the name and the structure kind of came really quickly, and then but I love it. I think podcasts are so popular, but the market is so full, like there are so many podcasts out there, and so I do think we do offer something different, and I also think personally I would listen to our podcast. I do like to learn from podcasts.
What is it people can expect to hear when they listen to your podcast? What makes you two stand off?
So I think we like to alternate the episodes between like harder top subjects and fluffy stuff. So like either end of the spectrum, like, you know, Catholic guilt and aliens. Nice. So, like, that
I mean, we're there. We wanted to cover subjects that are, like, that affect me and Al. Yeah. And I think that's a really, you know, integral part of a podcast is that the hosts have either a problem that they're trying to solve themselves in their lives, or they've solved a problem. So that's always, we have some episodes that are like that where, you know, Al spoke about addiction and her experience, and that to me was like the best episode I think that we've done, because that wasn't necessarily, you know, all about the lols and the comedy, but it was an episode where you just really spoke from your heart. And to me, that is like, I've had so many messages about that podcast saying it's just so amazing to hear someone's experience, someone who's young and been through that. And then I gave like a bit of the science about addiction and what the neuroscience of addiction is and what we know so far in research, and how addiction and the stigma around that is really shifting now, and the science is showing that addiction is not a choice really. So that was a really, we have those types of episodes that are really like like deep, and then we go to other things about accents and silly things like that.
I don't know, it's weird though that you like, you can, you enjoy different aspects for different reasons, because you do like want to get into the nitty gritty of the hard stuff, and then you also want to be like, lol, my nan met an alien once, and like, you know, telling people about that.
In Widnes, the aliens came to Widnes.
They did. Yeah. They were just like, honestly, we were like, my nan was in Widnes. She's rolling in the grave. She met an alien and. Well, saw a UFO.
Yeah, she didn't meet an alien.
And told me and was like, don't tell anyone.
So Alex didn't.
And so I didn't for a long time until I mentioned it on a podcast.
She told me all those years later on a podcast.
And I was just like, isn't this crazy? And then we were like, obviously just like, you know, what they went back and they were like, oh, you should have seen her face. Like, it's so fucking funny. Like, can I swear on this one?
Of course you can, yeah.
Cool. But yeah, so it's just, it's really nice to, like to listen to make something that you are proud of, but also that you would watch and you would listen to. Like, I'm sure with this, like, you want to watch it
every week.
Love listening to my own voice. So yeah, no, it's so good. I just feel like Julia does a lot of like editing because of like YouTube and having a YouTube channel.
And I'm a control freak.
That's like, because your social media platform is out there, isn't it? Like, for everything from TikTok to everything. Like, you are so
And it's all you as well, which is just like,
it's a lot.
I've offered to help, like, under my breath. Like, should I? No.
You do listen to the podcast and tell me which bits to cut. And Alex is very indecisive, people pleasing way. Maybe this bit could go, but if you want to keep it, it's fine. That's literally, I get a list of like five things. Like, maybe this, not too sure, it's quite good.
I know this from Alex. Obviously, me and Alex met years and years ago through like acting and stuff like that, but then like found each other again through comedy, didn't we? And then like, we started, I think it was the same month we started comedy, like February 2019.
Yeah.
We started comedy around the same time, and we were in a WhatsApp group, and you'd send Alex like, does this work, like this joke work, and she'd be exactly the same. She'd be like, it's funny, but if it was me, I'd say this, and just change the complete joke on you, but then say, but it's still good the way you've done it. But obviously comedy, Alex, you have found your feet in it, because you are absolutely smashing it at the minute.
Oh, thanks.
I was hoping that you'd actually take that and like come back with something, but but it is like, you're busy now. You're at a good level with your comedy, aren't you?
I'm trying. Like, I think getting sober was it's one of the gifts of my sobriety is telling dick jokes to people on stage. That's why I don't drink anymore. It's all for that dick joke. But honestly, it's been like one of the best things I've ever done, and it's that thing of like, I've been able to say to so many people, like, when you've been in like, you know, the worst place in your life, and I don't know, like, you know, if you may die on stage, but you won't die. Like, it becomes very small fry.
Yeah.
And so that's why, like, even though you can get nervous and go, oh, what's this? This is because I care and that makes me feel uncomfortable. But also it is like, this really doesn't matter. Like, and it can still, you can still, you know, give it your all, and I'm super reliable now. I'm not a pisshead, so that's great. And so it's finding how would you get sober and not find the fact that
obviously you've had your demons, you've fought them, and you've come out the other side. But the way you have brought that to the stage in comedy as well, it's such a talent to be able to look at yourself and laugh about what you've been through when it was so hard.
Yeah.
And I mean, again, it just shows how brilliant you are at your comedy game as well.
Yeah.
But girls, thank you very much for coming. These have been great guests. Just before you go, where can people listen to your podcast, find you on Instagram and stuff like that? Stage is yours. Look into any camera, you can tell them.
Do you want to do the podcast first?
Yeah, because I do it at the end of every episode. So you can find us. No, I still have it written down now. So we are at Hypothesis Podcast on Instagram, at Hypothesis _pod on Twitter.
Very convincingly said.
Hypothesis Podcast on Facebook, and you can also email us if you listen and have potential hypotheses, but you'll hear that at the end of every episode. And then I'm also Alex Stringer 5 on like everything, and
I'm Julia Ravy Science on everything with various dots in between, but if you type Julia Ravy Science, it'll come up. Yeah, I don't know why I did that. Everything is Julia Ravy Science with spaces or dots or all together as one, but it's different. Ravy's a weird name,
clever,
so find
but
it.
Not that clever.
Yeah, I'm definitely not.
Girls, thank you very much. Guys, that's Alex Stringer and Julia Ravy. Thank you very much.
Thank you for having us.
Now, to end the show is musician Sam Hepworth. I really hope you enjoy his music. Before Sam comes on and performs, please go onto YouTube and subscribe to our channel. Type in Friday Night with Dean Aldridge. There's all the clips from the first season. There's all the short clips and that from your favourite musicians like Ryan Rooney and Daisy Gill. But we'll be back next week. Here's Sam.